Please join me in welcoming the Honorable James Frank and the Honorable Ina Minjarez. Thank you for being here. Welcome. Good to see you. Rep, thanks for being here. Good morning. As I said to you when I walked in, good thing you're not on state affairs, right?
That's right, amen.
You would have come straight over.
Yeah.
Just because that just happened like 2 hours ago, I just need to take the opportunity to ask you for the Simmons bill.
Yes.
You think the Simmons bill is going to pass the House?
I believe it's going to pass the House. It looks, your guess is likely as good as mine.
Right. It was left in committee last night, but that's kind of how Byron Cook rolls typically in cases like this. That's not a sign of where this is. Well, God, it was 4:30 in the morning. Who could vote at 4:30
in the morning?
Rep. Minjarez, are you for the Simmons bill?
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not. You think the votes are there? You're a pretty good vote counter. What do you think?
Votes could possibly be there, but we'll see if it gets to the floor.
So you think there may be this effort to keep it from ever getting to a vote?
I think so.
Okay, good. Let me ask the two of you about foster care. That's the topic of today. There's certainly plenty to talk about in here. I want to come to a better understanding of exactly how we got to the point where this was at the top of the agenda. Every session, you have the meat and potatoes issues, public ed, transportation, healthcare, but then a couple of issues that are a little bit more boutique-y, a little bit more specific and narrow, jump to the top of the list. This session, it seems like, Representative Frank, CPS got there, and I wonder if this is all about Judge Jack's decision just after you all gaveled down in 2015, a few months after, saying that the system of foster care administered by the state was unconstitutional. Did she make this happen?
I certainly think that's part of it. I mean,
yeah.
When you have a lawsuit, that's certainly part of it. I think it's also been about 12 years since we last took a deep dive into CPS, and I think if you look historically, there's a cycle of when you address an issue, and I think there's also an understanding by both sides of the aisle that, although thankfully we don't have aisles in Texas, like we actually talk to each other.
Right.
But I think there's an understanding on both sides that it is a core function of government, and it's important. And so I don't think that there's an argument on either side of the importance of it. And I think that also helps elevate it. And certainly the news media also has done a good job of outlining some of the significant problems that are there.
The reality is that, as you say, 12 years. I mean, the fact is that 12 years since the last time that the state looked at it seriously.
Yes.
But the problem has existed long before it got on everybody's radar screens a couple of years ago again, right?
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah, the challenges have been there. And look, I mean, there's serious challenges in our culture and in our society. You know, these are not easy issues. Everybody wants very easy fixes to these issues. These are very deep problems.
Right.
And the government can intervene in some.
Right.
Some of them are almost unfixable unless they're fixed at the family level.
Right. And in some respects, Representative Minjarez, this is a little bit like the school finance issue. If it were easy to fix, it would have been fixed long ago.
Right.
That's why we're still talking about it, not because it's easy, but because it's hard.
Yeah, exactly. You know, the judge definitely brought this issue to the forefront, in my opinion.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, I think time was wasted when the Attorney General kept appealing and appealing. And now, we're finally here. And we are going to have to, beyond the 85th, I believe,
yeah,
we're going to always be constantly having to work on this issue.
Conversation is not going to end when you all gavel out.
Exactly.
Right. What you're alluding to is the fact that the judge in December 2015 said the system is unconstitutional. This was the basis. The basis for this ruling was a class action suit filed on behalf of 12,000 kids in Texas. Judge came back and said system is unconstitutional. Appointed two special masters to investigate the system. Special masters came back last November and said here are 50-odd recommendations. And actually, there was pushback, Representative Minjarez, was there not, on this idea that somehow a court-ordered solution was going to be the solution that the state embraced. The Attorney General's office said, among other things, we don't want an unelected federal judge telling us what to do. It'll be legislators who will solve the problem.
Right.
Right. You agree with that?
You know,
you mind being told what to do?
I want to be part of the solution.
Right.
We have an obligation. These children are taken into custody by the state.
Yeah.
So we're obligated to fix a broken system, and that's what we're committed to do.
Right. I mean, of course, you could say, Representative Frank, that the federal court is only acting because the legislature had not acted. And if the idea is leave it to the legislature to fix it, the question is, where have you guys been?
Well, I think in reality, the legislature has acted. Some of these are very, very difficult solutions to fix. You know, you mentioned the courts. You know, in many cases, the courts have actually taken over the systems in states through court order.
Indeed.
Those states are not performing well. Okay, so these are not solutions that you go, you know what, if I just put this plan in place, we can fix it. They are very, very difficult issues to fix. They require money, but they also require intelligent solutions.
You had an opportunity to look at the special master's recommendations. We won't go through all those, but do you generally agree with the assessment that the special masters had of the system?
I agree with some of them and some of them not. I mean, they had,
right.
to your point, 50
More than 50 recommendations.
And look, we had the Stevens report, you know, they had a lot of, I think, very good. I think the Stevens group did a lot better job of laying out what the solutions were. And I think
right.
a lot of these are already in process of being implemented.
Yeah, Representative Minjarez, Representative Frank said something to the effect that there are no aisles in Texas. Of course, there are aisles. There are a lot of issues.
Of course,
there are a lot of issues on which the aisles are.
We do actually talk to one another, and
right.
I think that's evident in some of the solutions we've come up with.
But on this issue specifically, Representative Minjarez, this does seem to be one of the rare bipartisan issues in this legislature. There does seem to be, generally speaking, not perfect agreement, but there does seem to be generally agreement on both the nature of the problem, the cause of the problem, and what the potential solutions are. Yep.
And we want to make sure that we work together on policy, on solutions, talking, arguing, getting in the room, and visiting with stakeholders, and just making sure that we can collectively make the changes that are needed, or at least start the process on this change.
Right. Can you help us understand how we got to this point? What exactly is the problem with the system? Have you been able to distill it down? If one of your constituents came up and said, I understand you've been working on this issue all session, what is the problem we're trying to fix?
I think that the CPS system has been, in my opinion, it's been neglected for a very long time. There's not one simple answer.
Is it mismanagement by the state? Is it the legislature not providing enough resources to enable CPS or DFPS to do their jobs?
Yes and yes.
So it's both and.
Right. Just one specific reason, but unfortunately, we are so limited in our time on addressing issues. We meet every 2 years for the legislative session, and we're condensed in so many months and trying to fix so many problems.
Right.
We don't have the time to address all of our issues in Texas, and I think that's what happened, is that CPS was neglected for such a long period of time, and now here we are years later, and we've got to get together and find some solutions.
Representative Frank, it wasn't as if all of a sudden foster children started sleeping in state offices or in,
right.
I mean, this problem had existed for some time. My question is, how did it get to the point that it was so broken? What was the cause?
Well, I think there's a number of things. If you want to boil down the foster care problem, there's a lack of foster homes. I mean, we need more adults to
right.
step up and be foster parents. When you look at so many of the problems, whether it's sleeping in offices or being taken out of a home and then moved to a far different place, it's a lack of foster homes. That requires, I mean, that is something that the government is supposed to be.
Can I see you?
You may.
Yeah.
You're doing anything you can to keep that from happening.
So we're supposed to have more, or we'd ideally like to have more foster homes, but we simply do not.
I mean, that capacity issue is a huge issue. Fundamentally, that's one of the, you know, you mentioned sleeping offices. The only reason somebody is removed from home and has to sleep in an office is if there's not foster care capacity.
Right.
Okay, and so, and that's something that we need to fix, and I think one of the solutions, as we talk about solutions, that has been worked on really for 6 years is going to more of a community-based model.
And if
you look at the Tarrant County, the seven counties around there, for the last 2 years, there have been zero kids sleeping in offices because there is an organization that is responsible for those seven counties and has to make sure,
right.
and does make sure, that there are available foster homes.
Now, there are, to the two of you, there are lots of things that have come up in the course of the session discussed as pieces of legislation that have been put forward as potential solutions, but almost every solution that is discussed at the Capitol begins with money. Texas has historically underfunded, relative to need, the foster care system. For a while, we were, I think, at about 38% of the national average. I think we've moved up now that we're about half of the national average on what we spend on foster care.
Well, I think those statistics, as all many statistics, are a bit misleading. It depends a lot of times on how many kids you're removing.
Right.
So if you're saying Texas is not removing enough children, and I don't hear people saying that.
No, I think we're removing about half
of what some of the higher cost states are removing.
Right, but I think just generally speaking, if you look at the appropriation, and in fact the reality is, speaking of 50%, CPS has asked for about twice what both the House and the Senate have appropriated in this case. My question is money an issue legitimately? Has money been an issue?
And if money is an issue, why are we not seeing more money go to solve this problem this session?
Well, money is always an issue. And yeah. I think the legislature has obviously put quite a bit more money in this session, but let's also not pretend that this is the only solution, because right. You know, we act like we're just now addressing this issue. In the last 12 years, or actually in the last decade, we've put 85% more money in, 85% more money with 20% more kids.
Yet the system is not fixed.
Right. And so if money alone were the solution,
right.
It would have already been fixed.
Why do you think,
it is not the only thing.
Rettman-Harris, why do you think Commissioner Whitman and CPS is asking for more money than you've been providing? Are they asking for too much, or do you just not have enough to give them?
I think at the end of the day, we're fighting over a tight budget.
Yeah.
Public education, we were dealing with the school finance issue yesterday. There's so much need in the state of Texas, and we are limited in our budget. I'm very happy that we were able to give CPS additional funding, but of course, I wish we could give more.
Yeah.
But it's not always the only solution. We got to go in there and actually dive in there and pinpoint the other problems with the system and address those. So it's not always just money.
There was a discussion early in the session, representatives, about more caseworkers and higher pay for the current caseworkers and non-caseworker staff at CPS. And in fact, there was some reporting, Representative Frank, in the last 2 weeks that said that with raises now there has been some progress made already,
right.
Just on the basis of those dollars being appropriate.
Right. Yeah. I think that's not probably a newsflash. If you pay people more money, you're going to probably have less turnover. And
right.
That is certainly the case.
Yeah. So that was the desired effect.
But again, it's not just money. It's also work environment as well. That money was not the number one reason people are leaving. It's the work environment, and so the better we make that. Some of that is pay.
Yeah.
Some of that is staffing.
Some of that is reducing the load.
Some of that is how we talk about it.
Reducing the caseload also, right?
Yeah, some of that is that. Some of that is how we talk about them. I mean, at the end of the day, part of the problem with CPS is the only time we talk about them is when something bad happens. We have 30,000 kids in foster care, and the only time we will talk about a CPS worker is when something bad happens.
Right.
And that's a shame on legislators and also, maybe towards media, that the only time we talk about CPS workers, why would you want to be a CPS worker when the only time you're mentioned is when something bad happens.
Right, but of course,
let's talk about what some of the great, there is some great work that happens in CPS.
But of course, as you both know, not just the media, but the legislature can also be fairly said to pay attention to things only at the point of crisis.
Right.
Why are you fixing school finance this session? Because school finance is in crisis, and we just had a court case. Without that gun put to the heads of the legislature, wouldn't you say it's often not the case that these issues get addressed?
I completely agree. I practiced in the courts, children's courts in Bexar County.
Yeah.
And saw, incredible caseworkers doing incredible work. They're passionate. This is what they do. And unfortunately, because of the pay or because of the low morale, the stress of the job, we lost quality caseworkers. They ended up leaving to go into maybe teaching or other areas. And very rarely are they praised. You're completely right. It's always when there's a tragic situation that happens and it's attacking caseworkers and attacking CPS.
Do you have a sense, Representative Minjarez, of what Commissioner Whitman and the agency believe that they would have gotten had you appropriated everything they'd asked for that they're now not going to get? Do you have a sense of what's left on the table in this legislative appropriation?
Commissioner Whitman's he's been so incredibly, he's been great. He has been part of our work groups. He has always been open with communication in terms of what he needs and in letting us know. I know that he wanted additional funding for additional resources, but I trust, he will continue to guide us in the process. We're gonna go beyond the 85th, I trust that he's gonna let us know what he's gonna need on his end.
Right. As you know, Representative Frank, Governor Abbott has the opportunity in his State of the State to identify emergency items for Texas. He gets to pick whatever items he wants to elevate and give you the opportunity to address sooner. And CPS was not only one of those, but it was his first emergency item. Mm-hmm. Does the fact that it was the governor's emergency item in any way make this issue more solvable or resolvable? Does it give you any more of a motivation to resolve it? Does it mean anything that he's asked you to make it an emergency?
Well, of course it does. Yeah. I think it also is one of the things I didn't mention. It's one of the things that put a highlight on CPS.
Right.
Both Speaker Strauss, Lieutenant Governor Patrick and Governor Abbott, all of those, when all of those are focused on the same thing, it is pretty easy to get stuff done. If you look at some of the other issues that we may or may not make progress on, it's because you don't have consistency between the three.
So there's
it certainly helps
the,
when
the motivation is across the board in this case.
Well, you know you're going to get support.
Yeah. So let's talk about the status of the system right now. So there's been a bunch of reporting about the number of kids in state offices in the last couple of weeks. We've had a report by the Dallas Morning News that said that during the month of March, the number of kids who were sleeping in state facilities or in hotels or some other facilities had gone up by more than double. It had gone up from, I think, 29 in February to 65 in March. We had this awful situation, Representative Minjarez, in Houston, where you had two kids who were in the system but not in sufficient accommodation so that they fled. One was hit by a car and was killed. Should we expect a solution this quickly? I mean, you have this kind of reporting and you think, well, what's going on? I thought they were addressing this. But these kinds of solutions that you're putting into effect legislatively and in terms of the budget, it takes a little while for this stuff to actually make a difference.
That's what's so frustrating is we've been working since the summer. Mm-hmm. We have been putting our energy into bringing solutions to the table. But what's frustrating is that it moves slow.
Yeah.
And we wish if we could make it move faster, we would do it. And so that's what we're committed to doing. And we're hoping that, you know, placement is at the forefront. We definitely need more placements for these children and get them out of these offices.
Right. And so to that point, the legislation that has been discussed, at least in the House, there was the kinship care bill.
Yeah.
There's a bill to make DFPS a standalone agency, and there's a bill to put more of an emphasis on, as you say, community-based. Could you talk about the latter of those, the community-based provider? This is a bill of yours.
Yes, sir.
Right. Talk about what's behind that. Talk about what the challenges of that are, and then I want to get Representative Minjarez to talk about the good
and
bad.
And Senator Schwertner has this,
a version of that in Senate Bill 11.
Yes,
right,
that's passed the Senate. And
yeah.
So that's actually the only one that has the Senate and House companions. No, the concept is right now we're running the entire foster care system out of Austin.
Yep.
And if your issue is capacity, how well are you doing managing it out of Austin?
Yep.
You know, we're trying to recruit foster homes, and how engaged are we with the community, both with the faith-based and other organizations? How good of a job are we doing? We do not have excess capacity. That's the reason. You know, again, you get down to it. If you remove a child, do you have a home for them? And right now the answer is we're not doing a good job out of Austin. We don't run our school system.
In identifying
and training,
right.
And having those foster homes ready as soon as you remove a child, because that's the way CPS is doing, right? You remove a child, you remove them. You don't get to decide what time of day you remove them. You have to have a place for them immediately. If you don't have capacity for them, that's the reason they're in an office.
Right.
So what you're doing in the community base is saying it's your job in Fort Worth to make sure you have excess foster homes so that no matter what type of kid, no matter what type of need, no matter whether it's one kid or four kids, you've got a place for them immediately. It's that simple.
So the responsibility to identify those potential placements.
Identify them, train them, but you've got to recruit those. You've got to recruit those foster homes.
Right.
You have to make it a little easier. I think you know my wife and I have been foster parents. The amount of paperwork you might imagine working with the state. And look, I'm all for careful screening, making sure we have great foster homes, but the amount of silly paperwork and the amount, you know what I mean? There needs to be a lot of streamlining, and that is something that.
Yep.
Is probably not going to come out of Austin.
And the responsibility for vetting potential placements, families and other community-based providers, that responsibility would remain in Austin or should remain should go down to the local level?
Well, well over 90% of foster homes across the state are already done by private organizations.
Right.
That's already in effect. You don't really go to the state to become a foster parent. You go to private organizations. The coordination of that effort is what is done out of Austin.
Right.
Not the training
itself. And that's what you're suggesting.
And that's what we're saying. Look,
right.
This is too big of a state to try to figure out from Austin what's going on in Representative Minjarez's district and my district and try to engage with those organizations.
Yep.
And we need to break it down. And honestly, you know, we're having problems in CPS, but we're not having equal problems all across the state. Some places are running quite well. If you have good judges and you have good workers.
Well, you mentioned Fort Worth a couple times.
Fort Worth is the one,
right.
You know, right now they're the ones where it's community-based and we know exactly how things are going in that area. We know that you know, for instance, kids that are removed right now statewide, if you're removed from your home, you have a 30% chance of not being placed close to your home if you're anywhere else other than that seven counties.
Right.
You have a 16% chance of being placed away from your home if you're there, because they have increased capacity so that they're not having, and that's a big deal. And not only is it better for the kids, we have a whole group of workers at CPS whose job is to drive around the state because we haven't placed them close to home. Those people should be caseworkers, not driving around the state. It's just a more efficient way to run it.
Representative Minjarez, what do you think about this idea of moving more toward the community-based provider model that Representative Frank's talking about?
Representative Frank has worked so hard on this bill. And, you know, we've had hearings on HB 6 and hearings. And there's definitely strong points of the bill. There's points of concern about the bill. You know, one of the issues is privatization.
Yeah.
You know, some CPS workers have concerns about what their role is, or if they're even going to have a role.
That you would effectively be outsourcing what are their responsibilities or responsibilities of employees at the agency to private providers.
Correct. And when it comes to the legal side of these cases, when they've got to go to court, you know, are there definitive lines in who's representing who? Is the city or state attorney going to still continue to represent these organizations? Are they representing CPS? So we've had all of these different discussions.
Yep.
About the bill, and I think we're still continuing to have them, and we'll have them on the floor as well.
Show your hand. Where do you come down on this? You mentioned a couple of issues. Do you have concerns, personally?
I do. I have concerns, and mainly, and I've talked to Representative Frank about it, I want to see what amendments come down on the floor.
Yeah. Can you support the bill in its current form?
In its current form, I have concerns, but at the end of the day, I care. The best interest of the child is at the forefront of my decision.
Right.
I support the community-based model. There are concerns, so that's where I'm at. But again, I got to see what happens on the floor and what kind of surprise amendments can pop up.
Right. There was, not on this bill, but on another bill that you've introduced, there was a question about religious liberty, mm-hmm. Religious objections that some faith-based providers might have in making placements. Mm-hmm. Could you talk a little bit about that issue?
Well, it's not really in making placements. In CPS, the placement decision is responsibility of CPS. Again, CPS removes the child.
Yep.
CPS makes the placement. CPS is charged with and has to make the placement in the best interest of the child. So it is my belief, and I think all of our beliefs, that we need a diverse network of foster care providers so that CPS has the best ability to place the child where they best fit.
Yeah.
Regardless of what that is, whether they are, you know, really regardless of the child, that you can place that as well as possible. And so we don't want to get rid of any quality, say, foster homes.
Yeah.
Be they religious, be they LGBT. We want, I've said all skate, but that may show how old I am. We want all providers there.
Right.
As long as they're good quality providers. And we don't want the faith-based community being sued for stuff that has nothing to do with safety and well-being of the children.
Do you have any concern, Representative, about the faith-based community's place in this conversation?
I do.
Can you explain?
I have concerns about, CPS provides a child a Bill of Rights. I don't know if you're aware of this, Evan. And in that Bill of Rights, and you can pull it up on the website, it says that a child is able to practice whatever religion that they wish to.
Right.
There are numerous rights. So I want to make sure that those rights aren't infringed upon by wherever placement they're placed. So, you know, that is my concern about it. And you know, there's have been claims about, you know, fear of being sued, claims that organizations have been sued. And I want to see that evidence if it's happened here in the state of Texas.
Yeah.
I still have not been presented with that evidence when asked for.
Yeah. Let me ask you about kinship care. So this was obviously a big conversation on the very first day that you all were able to consider legislation on March 1st. This mm-hmm. A big flap came up related to the Keogh Amendment over immigration status of the...
That's what she's talking about when she says amendments. It's like,
amendments.
Really? I thought we were on a kinship bill.
Amendments come up and they go down, as you know. But
right,
that
yes.
Was,
they,
but that was,
they don't often stick.
But that was... this is Representative Burkett's legislation,
absolutely.
Which is already...
Which was also part of the work group. And that's something... I mean, Cindy did a great job of carrying it, but it was certainly something that had bipartisan support.
People within the foster care universe will say, I believe this is generally accepted, that it is always better to place a kid with a family member, if you can do it.
If you have a family member
that can
handle it.
Are we doing enough as a state to provide whatever is necessary, resources or other support to families to take kids? Well, I'll let you, Representative Frank,
okay.
take that. Yeah.
That's fine.
Because I understand one of the issues is that when these families take on kids, that the resources provided by the state are not adequate to the responsibilities and the cost being asked to bear.
In an ideal world, and obviously we don't always live in an ideal world, in an ideal world, families take care of families. And the state doesn't need to intervene.
Right.
And really, for many times, this stuff happens without the state's intervention at all. You have a parent that's irresponsible, does something wrong, and the parent steps in.
Right.
Or excuse me, not a parent steps in, but a family member steps in.
Steps in, right.
And the state doesn't get involved at all, okay? The question of how much the state should get involved, should we try to help when a family member really needs help to take a kid? Absolutely, and we want to do that, but we also want to try to thread that needle because, it's easy to say, well, let's just give more money.
Right.
We don't have an unlimited supply of money. We're in a balanced budget state. We have competing resources. We need to take care of these kids, but we also need to expect that families are going to take care of families to the best we can.
Right.
And then we're going to try to provide help.
I guess the question is whether the state sufficiently provides the resources to bear the cost of taking these kids in or taking the responsibility on, in your mind.
If you're saying, if a parent steps in, do we in all cases say, if a family member steps in, are we always writing a check and say, we will pay for any cost associated with that kid if you'll take it? No, we don't. We have an expectation that families are going to, that's not the role of government. No, we are trying to say, look, if that is the only thing stopping you and you are not willing or able to spend that money, then we need to step in. Then that's what we're trying to figure out. But it's very easy to just say, well, let's just give all the money, no matter what, and pay for everything.
Representative Minjarez, I'm sympathetic with Representative Frank's point of view on this. Obviously, you can't spend all the money that you have on even things that you believe are worthy. But if you're trying to encourage more family members to take in kids, there is a practical question of the cost of giving that child the opportunity and the life that you presume you want to give that child.
So I had a bill, Evan, and Representative Frank, we know where I'm going with this. I had a bill, that very contentious bill, HB 132. I found another source of financial help for families that where CPS does not get involved. So essentially, under the TANF, there is currently a $1,000 one-time payment given to grandparents that take in grandchildren.
Correct.
Okay.
It's a one-time payment, right?
Without CPS intervention.
Right.
So I worked on a bill that would open that up to uncles, aunts, or siblings of the child, and reduce the age, because right now it's required that you be 45 and older, reduce the age to 25 and older because grandparents are getting younger, et cetera. Worked very hard and diligently. There is no fiscal note. And you've still got to qualify. You've got to be at the 200% federal poverty level. You've got to, there's asset requirements, et cetera.
So you're saying it would not increase the financial obligation of the state.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I got a lot of opposition on that bill. It went for 2 days of debate. This would enable a one-time payment to have families at least start up costs for children coming into their home, whether it's cribs, shoes, medical, anything, just a one-time $1,000 payment with no fiscal note to the state. And it was a battle to get that through.
Right.
And luckily, I did have bipartisan support to get that over.
What was the objection?
I was expanding welfare.
Representative Frank, what do you think about that?
I voted for the bill. I think there is genuine concern from people that we are creating dependencies that aren't there, but there's also, we can talk about the things we disagree with. That bill passed with bipartisan support. Kinship care passed with unanimous support.
It did.
So we're trying to thread that needle. Yeah. I don't think Representative Minjarez wants to create people that are looking for handouts, and I don't think Republicans are trying to make it difficult for folks to intervene. But there's certainly.
Right.
Tension trying to thread that needle.
It just gets back to this question again. This is not so much to the two of you or on the two of you, but since the two of you are here.
We are here.
This is the issue. Governor identifies this as an emergency item. The system is clearly broken. Kids are literally dying before our eyes. The commissioner of DFPS comes to you and says, I need X. The legislature says it's a tight budget cycle. We can only provide basically half of X. Understanding that money is not the issue only. In an all funds budget of
$200 billion. We're talking about a couple $100 million more potentially to put to this problem. And the question is, you guys find it for a lot of other stuff. Why can't you find it for this? That's the question I'm asking.
I think one of the things too, Evan, that I should have mentioned earlier, you know, I think we definitely need to start looking at putting some funds towards prevention to begin with and education.
Right. Get out and on the very front end of
get
this.
Get on the front end of it.
Yep.
It ends up, you know, right. At the end of the day, we can resolve that or slowly start resolving it, but I really think we need to start right. Focusing on the prevention side and the education side.
Yeah. And I think there's only a certain speed at which money can be spent. I mean, he's having trouble.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? I mean, he is hiring people. But you also want quality people hired, not just
anybody.
Anybody hired. And so, you know, he is hiring, they are hiring, not just him, obviously in an area with 10,000 people.
Right.
But they are hiring very quickly.
Right.
And I think that there are already some improvements.
Right.
But, you know, I mean, clearly it's crisis because these issues are tragic issues. But it's interesting to look. When you look at how Texas compares to the rest of the country, do you know where we stand?
In terms of the measure of our system?
On federal measurements, if you know, federal, they have about 30 different measures.
Right. Where are we?
We're 25th out of 52.
So basically,
counting Puerto Rico and D.C. Yeah. Now, that's not something to be proud of.
The fact is, we like to be first at everything.
Well, and I think there's no question that we should be, but I think we need to be talking in terms of improvements.
Right.
You know, that we need to be getting better. Are we getting better? Because that's the problem. We've put a lot more money in, but are we getting better? And I think the answer is no, because we're always... There are going to be some bad things that happen. We need to have those happen less and less.
The fact is, you can't make those things go away completely, but you just have to reduce the frequency.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So we're talking about Commissioner Whitman. We're talking about the agency. So another piece of legislation this session, again, not particularly controversial, bipartisan support, is to make the FPS a standalone agency. Why is it necessary? What sort of reform will come or result will come from putting DFPS out there by itself?
I believe they'll be able to make much faster decisions.
The problem is that baked inside of a much bigger operation, the Health and Human Services?
Is delay in decision making.
Right.
And delays cause problems. Being able to hire and fire the people under you. You know, we hold somebody responsible that may or may not have the ability to do the hiring and firing underneath them. That is not, you know, at the end of the day, it'd be like hiring a coach but saying, by the way, you don't have personnel decisions underneath you.
Right.
We need to have somebody that is accountable. And I think with, you know, and I think the other thing it does is it elevates the importance of that job. It elevates in the eyes of other people.
It's a public message.
It's a public message that says this is important to the state of Texas.
Right.
And it has direct line of sight of the governor, direct responsibility to the governor. And I just think it shows that.
Right.
Yeah, it's a better organizational model, and I think it also sends the right message. Right.
Of course, theoretically, Representative Minjarez, governor's had his hand on this issue and on this job, the top job there anyway. But you're correct that identifying or isolating out DFPS as its own standalone does give them no, it's on you, basically, solve the problem.
Exactly, and I agree with Representative Frank, it's just gonna streamline processes quicker.
You don't get caught up in the politics of the rest of the agency.
Yeah. Exactly. And there are, you know, there were some consolidations made, there was a lot of discussions, there were some consolidations on some things. We're gonna keep those together where it makes sense. Some of the IT systems, payroll, those kind of things, those may make sense to continue. Yeah. To stay consolidated and efficient.
Right.
But when it comes to decision making that affects kids, we need to have a faster, streamlined, more accountable system.
Can I ask you what we're not talking about? So you said this is a problem that's not going to get solved in the 85th, and I agree with you. It's too large a problem to get solved within the footprint of this session. But obviously you're going to keep working in the interim, and you're going to come back in the next session and talk about this again. What are the next two or three issues that are going to be on our radar screen as it relates to this subject? Just as kinship and making DFPS a standalone or the community-based model became issues this time?
I think caseloads will always be an issue.
Yeah, reducing caseloads. But that's really the conversation we're having now in some respects, right?
Mm-hmm. It may not be right, but I'm going to answer a question with a question.
Sure.
How will we know when it's solved? What is solved?
What does success look like?
What does success look like?
Right.
And I think that's where we have to say, how do we measure ourselves? Mm. Is measurement saying in 7 million kids in Texas, nothing bad happens?
Right.
What is, and I'm not trying to set a low bar. I'm trying to set a bar of improvement where it's not simply reactionary to say, you know what, if we're in the middle of the pack, that's not acceptable to Texas. We need to be better than that.
Yeah.
But what does better look like? Does better mean we never take a 15-year-old child out of their home and they run away from that home and something bad happens? We're not locking these kids up. right?
Right.
We're not locking these kids up. If we're, are we really supposed to take a child out and lock them up? That can happen. I mean, our kid ran away from school. You know what I mean? And so we need to have a system that is focused on improvement, in my opinion. And I hope what we do next session is talk about, are we doing better than we were? Not are we perfect, but are we moved maybe from 25, are we down to 20? Are we making improvements?
And those will be goals set by the legislature or set by the agency?
Probably a little bit of both. Some is legislator, some is media. That's why I'm asking the question, what does success look like to all of us? I think we need to agree. I say I think we need to agree. I think we will all have that. But some people will always think it's in crisis because there will be something bad happen.
Right.
And some will look at and say, are we doing a better job?
Yeah.
And I hope that's what we're looking at is, are we improving? Are employees doing a better job? Are kids being put in the right homes? Those kind of measures.
Representative, do you have a sense of what success would be in your mind in this?
I think no system's perfect. But I think for success to happen, we've got to have definitely every stakeholder come to the table and talk with us and have frank discussions with us.
Frank discussions are always good.
And just, you know.
Discussions with Frank.
Discussions with
Frank.
Even
better, even better.
But no, I think one of the things is we have to just have some honest conversations about what's working and what's not working. I want to make sure that we're not coming in saying, we're telling you this is going to work. Because we're telling you it's going to work. We want to be, have honest conversations. Tell us where we didn't make right decisions.
Yeah.
And be honest with us so we can address it.
Okay. Let's go to questions from the audience. We've got a microphone. We'll walk around. If you've got one, we're happy to bring you into this conversation. Sir. Yes.
Thank you. I'm Daniel Yanis. I live here in Austin, Texas. I'm a community organizer. And had the fortunate or unfortunate opportunity to witness someone going through the CPS process, a 23-year-old mother with a 3- and 4-year-old and a husband who had mental problems and she was trying to hold her family together, had a restraining order against him because he went off his meds, that kind of stuff. So anyway, but I have actually three things, maybe a fourth that I'd like to touch on. One is I agree that I think more money, reducing the caseload of individual caseworkers is paramount. The other thing, and that is with money and employment, and I agree with you.
Make it a question, if you would, please.
A question?
Yeah, a question.
Well, I actually came to this to give you this information because I had a personal experience with CPS. So that's one thing that I will say is that's what should occur. More money, reduce the individual caseload of those people that will give them the ability to do a better job. The other thing is I think it's systemic. What I witnessed going through this process was an absolute lack of respect for the clients and the assumption that there was, I'll just put it very briefly and I'll finish.
Please.
And that is, in the petition, for example, I got to see the petition. The first paragraph talks about helping, trying to solve the problem. The next page and a half is about punitive. So similar to the police, people who work day to day with caseload must be able to determine the difference between good actors and bad actors.
So the client you're referring to in this case are the kids in the system, families in the system, or you're not talking about the caseworkers, you're talking about the end user, basically.
I'm talking, yes, the families. However, the interface with the bureaucracy is a big problem.
Do you worry, Representative Frank, Representative Minjarez, about whether the system is sufficiently respecting the people in these vulnerable positions?
I mean, I think that's always a case, and I'm sorry that you didn't have a great experience with CPS. Certainly we hear, and I know you do, of many of the bad cases, but I think where we have great workers, the system works well. And I know that sounds silly, so our job, I think, as legislators is to, how do we get better workers? How do we, think the pay is part of it, how we manage them
culture of the agency.
Culture of the agency matters.
And reducing caseloads.
Yeah.
And as an attorney, I represented parents who had children removed from them. So I have been actually in the trenches when I felt that clients weren't treated fairly and respectfully. I think one of the bills that's coming up is being authored by Representative Wu, and he's going to be dealing specifically with just the judicial system and the legal aspects to making sure that parental rights are protected as well. But I know as a committee, we always have at the forefront too to make sure that parental rights are definitely kept intact, that make sure that they're also given the resources they need and that they have a voice as well.
Good. Hi.
Hello, my name is Courtney Jones, and I'm the founder and executive director of Change One. I am also a former foster youth. I spent 10 years in the foster care system, and also I have been a kinship provider and also an adoptive parent. Okay. So I have a lot of questions regarding the community-based model. It's a concern of mine, the community-based model, about accountability. Okay. And DFPS being a standalone agency. And so my question to you is, how are y'all going to ensure accountability?
Accountability by community-based providers?
Yes.
Okay, what about that?
Well, I think one of the good things that we have shown as a state, when we use, you know, we say subcontractor, and by the way, they can be private or they can also be government entities. There are several different government entities that are reaching out that want the opportunity to be these providers. So it may be a private, it may be. But I think one of the good things is when a contractor is not doing their job, we are pretty quick to fire them. One of the challenges we have with the culture of CPS, when an employee is not doing their job, very often they are reassigned or promoted. And that is in the culture of the organization.
Well, Ken, it's in the culture of a lot of state agencies.
You said that, not I. But I, but yeah, it is. CPS, and at the end of the day, if we put the employees ahead of the kids, then shame on us. The good thing is, whether it's right or not, we never put the contractors ahead of the kids.
Who makes
there
the
will
call?
Be
who?
There will be a there will be consequences if a community-based provider does not do their job, they will be gone.
Who makes the call, though, Representative? Who makes the call in this case? Who ultimately has the line responsibility for determining whether a community-based provider is doing the job sufficiently and whether they should be busted?
Well, CPS, but certainly legislators will have input on that if there is a problem in an area. You know, the other good thing about the community-based, we will at least know where the problems are. We will know if there's a problem in Fort Worth. Right now we say, well, there's a problem in CPS. The reality is there are places in CPS where right. they're working quite well, thank you.
Yeah.
There really are. I mean, there are different parts of the state where right. where it works well, but we don't know those.
Representative Minjarez, I'm trying to come up with an analogy in state government for this, and I guess the only thing I can come up with, I will acknowledge it's not great, is that the charter schools. So we're going to have this additional opportunity for people in the form of charter schools. Do we have sufficient accountability over how those charter schools perform? Is TEA in its current state in a position to determine whether every charter operator is doing a good job or a bad job? There are some good and some bad. I wonder if it's a similar deal where the question is, do we have the resources to have the accountability?
That's
right?
My concern.
Yeah.
That has been my concern with this bill. And so I want to make sure there is accountability and who's going to be that neutral party that can address these concerns and address them sufficiently and effectively.
Is it ultimately CPS or is it going to be turfed down to the local level? What do you think?
Well, I mean, I would say one of the things, because most of the pushback has been with the decision. Do we remove
right.
or do we not remove the
right.
child? That decision is not with CPS. That decision is with the judge.
Correct.
The judge is the only one who makes that decision. So the judge provides accountability.
Yeah.
In this case.
I guess what the questioner is asking, though, is when you identify a provider that is part of this universe of care,
right.
the question is a provider at a level up from an individual case doing a sufficient job
right.
as a provider?
Yeah. And that will be
and that's more of
CPS
a CPS, not a
and
judge.
And the legislature.
Got it.
And I think the nice thing is at least we will measure them. I mean, we can show you reams of data on what's going on in seven counties because we are measuring it closely. And as we roll out others, you will know who is doing well.
Got it. Sir, Mr. Nichols.
Representative Minjarez, you briefly touched on prevention as a solution to some of these problems. I was hoping you could elaborate on that a little more.
Yeah, that's great. Please, what does prevention mean? What can you all enable or facilitate in that?
You know, I think this is where we really need to bring in our community partners. Every community is different, so the needs are different. But organizations, community partners to get out there and start, you know, educating the community about the prevention aspect. having interest and letting the community know we all have a responsibility to these children, whether it's reporting abuse or neglect, whether playing some part in resolving the issue. It may be with young parents that don't have any parenting skills and giving them the resources they need and letting them know, hey, if you have an issue, you can come to us and don't be fearful your children are gonna be taken away. There could be another instance, there's different organizations in the United States where a mother may have an infant and may be having just a really bad day and can take this infant to this organization to have a time out so that she doesn't act out on the child. I think organizations like that, prevention, are so key to making sure we give the services we need to these vulnerable people in our communities.
And I very much agree. I do think CPS is going to always have a hard time doing prevention. It's hard to be CPS. I'm from CPS. I'm here to help you. Because they are the ones who can remove your child. I think the state has a role, but I think other organizations, even other state organizations, are a more a better spot for prevention. Again, CPS needs to have a role, and the state needs to have a role.
We can't do it alone.
Well, and really, CPS's job is calling balls and strikes on whether or not this child gets removed. To ask them to also be the one that somebody can go to and say, hey, I'm going to call the person who can take my child away for prevention is probably not going to happen. That's going to be other organizations, even other state organizations, I believe.
Agnes, you got one back there? Hi.
Hi, I'm Maria Medina. I had a couple of questions about the steadfastness of foster parents as a former foster parent and as a member of various groups that that through reading the posts, I see that there is a lack of oversight by CPS on their caseworkers and the decisions they make. There is a great deal of subjectivity that comes into the decisions that CPS cares, that might be an implicit racial bias. And also, sorry, I have my notes. I really think it's important. I really want to know the statistics on how many foster parents stay in the game, because I know of many that have done it once and say they can't do it again. Yeah. And also, I would like to know, the only thing I can find on CPS is the policy manual, and I think that for transparency's sake, it would be really beneficial for us to be able to actually know what the trainings are and what type of things they look at that might differ from what the popular, what normal population might see as red flags.
Well, let's give them an opportunity to answer that. So you're a foster, you are a foster parent. So you have had experience
yes,
with the system.
We were foster parents. We've adopted, but we're not now.
Right, but you have yes, experience yes. with the system. So taking off your legislator hat and putting on that hat, do you think the system treats you and people like you well?
In fact, it is incredibly difficult to work with the state as a foster parent. From a paperwork standpoint, you know, it's tough enough you're bringing a child into your home that may come with a little bit of baggage. I mean, kids don't really have baggage, but they have some damage. And so you have all of those extra efforts, and then you add on top of that paperwork upon paperwork upon paperwork, which is obvious, which is also, by the way, one of the reasons that people leave CPS, mm-hmm. because paperwork.
The requirements are burdensome.
I always give it, because the most frustrating example is on a quarterly basis, you fill out an inventory of clothing down to the underwear level. So literally, my wife is going through the dirty clothes looking for socks and underwear to put on there. Maybe that doesn't need to be done. That is a less talked about, because it's a less controversial part of HB6.
But we need
to streamline, because we ask for the silliest things to cover.
Do you think parents going into the system, potential foster parents, are aware of the requirements of them? Is the agency transparent enough on the front end?
I don't know. Everybody's probably different. I think certainly there is an understanding that being a foster parent is not a fun thing to do from a paperwork standpoint. I think that certainly discourages people from doing it. I think there's some things we can do to make it a lot easier. I understand there's documentation that is needed. I really do. But we might be able to minimize it. Actually, we should be able to minimize it quite a bit. And honestly, that's one of the things, you know, when you talk about why a standalone agency. Well, trying to get just that decision and streamlining done in an agency of as big as HHSC is a lot harder. There is no reason that we can't do that in 3 to 6 months.
If you take it out. Representative Minjarez, the questioner also asked about racial bias potentially within the system. I know that 2/3 of the kids in foster care are non-white
right. In
Texas right now. Do you have any concerns about a racial aspect to the services provided or the performance of CPS?
I do. Every safety plan that's offered, every service plan that's offered, you know, it's very, it tends to be subjective. And sometimes what I worry about with these services that are offered to parents is, are they able to really complete the plan? Sometimes they're set up for failure. And so my concern and some of the bills that are coming up, one bill in particular wanted to do some kind of focus on low-income zip codes, which I had an issue with that. Mm-hmm. Why?
Because to me, it wasn't mine.
It wasn't yours, but what I'm saying is, you and I both, mine. But you and yeah, I both yeah. had concerns
you,
about just, that
you were,
bill.
You were pointing yeah. toward the Capitol.
Right.
Yeah,
there yes. you go. they're targeting.
I just
wanted
to be clear.
They wanted to specifically do this focus on these low income neighborhoods, and why? Just because they're low income? That's not right. So we've got to be really careful as policymakers. We may have good intentions, but not necessarily the right thing to do, and you're just setting up people for failures.
Well, the reality is everything, you both know this, reality is everything gets politicized.
Yeah. Yes.
There's not a way to take the politics out of this.
No, and to add on to what Representative Minjarez was saying, I think we have to recognize when we remove a child, we create trauma. Mm-hmm. We create damage to that kid when we remove them. Now, it may be important enough to do it, but we need to be real sure.
Right.
And that's where the targeting and some of that stuff. And I think we do have some very well-meaning people that say, well, you know what, this child's a little too poor, or this child, we need to be very careful with that.
Got it. Anybody else for these two? Sure, we'll have you, we'll give you an opportunity to ask one more, and then we'll make that the last one. Yes, ma'am.
So I have a question regarding kinship. It baffles me when people say that family should take care of family, but yet we pay foster parents, complete strangers, to take care of kids. And so from the prevention standpoint, wouldn't it make more sense to support families in order to not have them come into the CPS system, is my first question. And to kind of go along with that, what are y'all gonna do to focus on middle class families? As a person that has a master's in social work and took in two kids at one time, I had to get two car seats, two beds, two of everything.
Right.
And because I'm middle class and I do not meet the poverty line, I didn't have any support. And I continue to keep working with kinship families that are taking in sibling right. groups of four. But yet they're not getting any support as well because they're middle class. So what are y'all gonna do to focus on prevention of kinship and helping them to support family?
Representative Minjarez, this does get to what we were talking about earlier, that on the one hand we're saying we believe that the system and evidence and history has proven that it is better for kids to be Absolutely. With their family, but on the other hand, in some ways, we penalize, right? We don't provide these families with the resources by virtue of being of family members,
no,
right?
She's exactly right. And we should be giving these kinship families all the resources that we need to make sure that these children thrive, to make sure that they stay with their families. And that's a frustration I have. And I'm hoping to work on legislation in next session, and I hope you will be a witness for me in trying to get the help needed, because I already got a lot of pushback on my HB 132 for, poor families, and so,
right.
but I'm intending to continue yeah. that fight and giving these kinship families the resources that they need so they can hold on to these kids.
We actually hear on the question of being a middle-class Texan and in some respects suffering for not being poor enough. This is a thing we hear all the time. You hear it in financial aid conversations, right, in higher ed. We know this barbell problem exists. Mm-hmm. What do you do about that?
Well, because the easy answer is obviously just give everybody money, right?
Asking for any answer.
No. I mean, I think that's what we do in trying to. I keep saying thread the needle, but it's hard to say. Okay, where is that line? Nobody wants to give the rich family government aid, right? And then defining where that is and where is middle class and where you help. That's
That's what we get all the debates about. That's what we get paid the big bucks for.
That's the big challenge. Yeah, yeah. The big bucks. That's
the big
right.
bucks.
Yeah. All right, let's thank Representatives Frank and Minjarez. Busy time in the session. Good to have them here. Thanks to all of you. We'll see you again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it, Representative. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Rep, thanks. Good
Happy
to see
birthday.
You again.
Thank you. I think we were together last year in San Antonio.